Hello everybody, I don't know whether I should say good afternoon or good evening. Okay, maybe I'll start with good afternoon and end up as good evening perhaps. I hope everybody is doing well, staying home and staying safe. My name is Natarajan. I am presently a professor of physics at the Indian Institute of Technology, Tirupati. Some of you might know that we have what is known as the 3G IITs, third generation IITs. We used to have several IITs before, the first generation, which were about 8 IITs, Bombay, Delhi, Madras, etc. Later we had another 8 at Hyderabad, Bhubaneswar, etc. Now recently, 2015, 6 more new IITs were started, and IIT Tirupati also started in 2015. So I worked in IIT Madras before that for about 40 years, and after retirement, the government of India requested me to help mentoring a new IIT at Tirupati, and that is why I am in IIT Tirupati. So I am very happy today to share with you from my home, okay, some ideas that I have on the impact of this COVID-19 on our lives, maybe in future. This is almost an unprecedented war-like situation. Okay? Somebody compared it to almost like a war. It's a little more complicated than war, according to me. In a war, you know, you are again asked to stay at home or stay underground sometimes. And if you come out, you know, you will get the risk of facing the crossfires. And it may be a life and death problem for us. In the similar sense, we are now asked, due to the lockdown, we are asked to stay home and stay safe, because when you come out, you may be getting coronavirus communicated to you, and therefore we must make sure that we keep at home, we keep safe, we move only when it is very necessary, and especially older people should not at all go out. In a war, this is a different kind of a war that what we are now facing. Because, you know, here it's an invisible army. We do not know with whom we are fighting. I mean, it's a virus, but you cannot see them, you know, it's almost invisible. And but you can imagine the impact that this virus can bring about in the lives of every country. Okay, irrespective of whether it's a rich country, poor country, geographical location, political lenience, okay, none of them matter, economic condition, class, creed, whatever. So it can affect anybody, anywhere. As a matter of fact, you know that the advanced countries are going through a much more tougher time than India in one sense. But still, we are not out of it yet. But we also do not know, the war is on still, because numbers are increasing, decreasing, it's fluctuating, and we are worried about communicating the disease to larger group, especially in a country like India, where we don't have very high levels of medical support system. But then, many experts predict that this is going to be with us for a long time, maybe even a year or more. It can never become zero. I mean, so it will asymptotically go to zero. That means it will keep on decreasing. First, the present concern is to make it flat, and then we have to try to see how to bring it down, so that this usually happens in two situations. One, either we identify or discover a new vaccine, which is also not happening at this stage. A lot of work all over the world is going on to find the vaccine for this. The other way it can happen is by developing immunity for the new kind of virus over the period of time. When more and more people get affected, herd immunity they call it, then automatically we develop a kind of a immunity, thereby we may be able to control the spread, and finally it may come to a very low levels of this. Okay, now the impact of this COVID-19 coronavirus thing is going to be there for a long time, and it will affect several of our activities in future. But I am interested, because I am working in an educational institution, I am trying to think through with your company, when you are all listening to me, what would be the impact of this coronavirus on the field of education, about which many of us are concerned. See, many of the schools and colleges have abruptly been closed. So that means there are still some portions, some instructions have to be completed, examinations will have to be conducted at the school level, as well as especially the graduating students in the college and university levels, and we do not know what is going to happen and when it is going to happen, because we all know the schools and colleges will be the last thing the government will think of reopening, because we have to how to establish this social distancing in a classroom situation or on a playing ground or in the hostels is very, very difficult, especially with young children. And therefore, this education field will face very tough time ahead. You also know that many of the competitive examinations like the JEE, NEET, have also been postponed indefinitely. We do not know. They are saying maybe by July or something, but we do not know. As on present, you can suggest a date when it can perhaps be started. But no one can predict whether we will be able to do that during July or August. And that means what? Even the next academic year is going to be impacted by this COVID-19. We really do not know when our schools and colleges, new admissions will happen, new set of students will join some of these institutions, etc. But in the midst of all this gloomy, apparently gloomy situation, there is always a brighter side. That is what I wanted to talk about. See, whenever there is a setback, human beings will start stopping for some time, pondering over the whole situation and see how to get out of the situation. Survival, that is the most important mantra. So you find that this kind of a pandemic that has come into our midst makes us think in newer ways and find newer ideas, newer designs, how to overcome the present situation. You would have already seen many of the manufacturing companies in India started making very quickly, even though that is not in the line of their production. They started making surgical masks, and then the face masks, face shields, ventilators at very low cost. So these technologies have reasonably been in a good shape now. Otherwise, we would not have gone into a research or a development of these kind of PPE, personal protection equipments for the police force, for the medical warriors who are at the front line, etc. So similarly, even in education, you find all the students are confined to their rooms, in their homes, and we do not know how to keep them engaged. They cannot go out, they cannot play, there is no vacation, there is no classes for them. So every school, college started looking at options available, whether we can still reach out to students and then take some of the lessons while they are at home. There are a lot of challenges, obviously, you can see. One of the biggest challenges that we have is the internet connectivity. While it is reasonably okay in places like towns and cities, etc., in some remote villages, internet connectivity may be a big issue, and therefore it may be very difficult to include some of those students who are in those kind of areas into our classrooms. However, you would have already seen, some of you would have also attended online classes under these conditions. For example, all IITs, including IIT Tirupati, we have been conducting our courses online and with the same timetable, and students log in and then they are able to follow the lectures, and therefore, but it is not as good as actually sitting in a physical classroom, we agree. But even then, it's at least something which keeps them engaged so that they are able to listen to some of the lessons, and later on when they come back to our classrooms, we may be able to revise and maybe strengthen their understanding even if they have a doubt. Because one of the major difficulties in terms of this online teaching, as they are called, is that you cannot immediately raise your hand and ask for a doubt to be clarified. Of course, there are some tools available modern days where you can ask a teacher, even in this internet teaching mode, you can, through chat mode, you can ask a quick question to the teacher, and that chat window will open up for the teacher, and he will be able to identify the question that a particular student asks, and then he may perhaps be able to address that question, because that question may be there in the minds of many of his students also in the class. But then, with all those limitations, this opens up an enormous opportunity, and you may be surprised that at all levels, including, for example, I will be happy to share with you, even my granddaughter, who is only 3 years old, she is in a daycare center, and she had few sessions of online teaching. Do you believe it? Okay. So people are quick to adapt to newer technologies, newer ideas, when they face with such unprecedented and difficult situations. You might also remember, this is nothing very special, because there are many people who are already attending or taking courses like arts or dance or music, yoga for example, etc., through Skype or through some other scheme like this, anywhere in the world. That is a very interesting part of it. Okay, you can learn, for example, many people in the US, United States, and other outside countries where they are not able to get good teachers in their neighborhood, then they don't mind coming through Skype and then learning from experts in India or elsewhere. So this distance learning, in one sense, have been there around, and it is going on. I'm sure many of you know also that in India there are a lot of people, there are a lot of IT companies which are trying to provide tuition to school kids in the US. Tutoring on one-on-one. That means what? One teacher in India, maybe in the middle of the night, because then only it is daytime for the people in the US, they will be teaching a school kid who just came from the school to complete the homework. So these are already there, such things, such systems are there where you may be able to educate or deliver educational content to people in any part of the world. One other thing that has become very popular during this lockdown period all over the world, of course, is a tool called Zoom. Some of you would have already used it perhaps or heard about it. Zoom, it's basically meant for some conferencing or some meeting in office. But then that has been used as a tool now for teaching. And you find it has got a lot of features which are very good for even teaching purposes. So, there is also another very important, see the Zoom, I wanted to say something more about Zoom. Zoom, it not started originally for the teaching purposes. It was more for a meeting inside an organization or something like that. But then in the present situation, it has become an important teaching tool. However, after you started using it, then you find it has got large number of problems. One of the major problems is the security issues. And so the Zoom, the people who are developing the Zoom, they are going back to the design table and trying to see how to improve the security issues, and they have started releasing newer versions with more protected facilities and things like that. We are also aware that distance education is a very, very important part of our university system. Almost every university with the name have got distance education department. Okay. So in the distance, and you, they award degrees also. Okay. You can register for a course, any course for that matter, except perhaps some engineering or science courses. Even in some universities, they have enabled that through the distance mode. In the, and we, you know, Indira Gandhi National Open University, IGNO, is one of the largest open universities in the world. And there is also another one which is called Athabasca University in North America. Athabasca is a mountain range in northern Canada. And on the basis, they have what is known as distance education university, and they claim more than 30,000 registrations in those universities. Because the distance education mode has got a wonderful opportunity that somebody who doesn't have too much money to spend on education, they can start working and simultaneously start registering for a course in a distance education university and then complete the course. There are many people in Northern America and other universities all over the world, they take up a normal university degree course, and in the meantime they find it is a bit expensive, they do not have money to continue their studies, they break their courses, they come out and start working, earning, and those people also register for this distance education more, because these distance education universities, they attract those people with a promise that if you do one or two courses with us, which are also part of the prescribed course for you in your own university, you can transfer the credit. We have an agreement with your university that whatever grades we award to you in our distance education mode, you may be able to take it over to your main university, and thereby you can complete your degree without attending your physical classroom in that university. It's a very attractive opportunity for many of the people who cannot afford large sums of money to study in leading universities all over the world. So this is one of the very interesting things. Yeah, in addition, I must perhaps share with you on another innovative idea where
the Athabasca University is offering a degree in MSc Physics. You see, the distance education mode is very compatible to many of the arts and social sciences kind of courses. In engineering, for example, or in physics, biology, chemistry, etc., you find there is always a laboratory component, which is equally important. While continuing your studies, you must be exposed to enough amount of a laboratory training to make you a wholesome person to take up either experimental or theoretical work later on. So in that sense, the distance education mode does not provide enough opportunity for hands-on laboratory training. But this Athabasca University, which I am referring to now, have got an MSc program with a very innovative idea. With the advent of computers, you can always have what is known as a data acquisition system. That means the computer can acquire data from the external world, measurement of temperature, for example, or voltage, or any other physical parameter, pressure or load, etc. So they design physics experiments based on certain sensors, and those sensor data are acquired by the laptop or a desktop computer, and therefore you can do physics experiments interfaced to your computer. So this university is what they do. They have made a lot of packages of experimental kits with the interface unit, and student can go to any nearest library, public library, for example, and then borrow, like you borrow a book, a small experimental kit, and take it home. And you have your own laptop, you connect the interface to your laptop, and you can perform a physics experiment on your own in the comfort of your house and collect the data through online, make some Excel graphs or data tables, etc., and then send them all through email to your mentor in the university, distance education university, and he can evaluate, and thereby you are also enabled to perform very good experiment. About 10 experiments you have to do over the semester, and that can be enabled through this very interesting innovative mode. So that is what I wanted to share with you. There is another very interesting thing that also is happening, as you are perhaps know. There are many leading universities, and especially in India also, when we had a large number of private engineering institutions started all over the place. Okay, one of the major issues that we faced at that time was getting good quality faculty to teach in those engineering institutions. So at that time, MHRD and IIT Madras, the then director, they came out with a very innovative idea that let us establish very good studios in our own institutions, IIT, and very nice, best teachers and professors in IIT who have got very wide experience. You can ask them to come into the studio along with the students. The studio will be a classroom kind of a setup. So the students can occupy their chairs and the teacher can go on. There will be a blackboard, there will be a projection unit, etc. All support systems are given, and the teacher can take the whole class under a camera, so that the entire teaching that the teacher does in the classroom can be recorded as a video, and that can be shared to anybody anywhere in the world. This program was called NPTEL, National Program of Technology Enhanced Learning. It's a national program, it is a learning program, it is technology enhanced. Making use of technology, you increase the accessibility of such good lectures by good professors to every part of India and the world. And it was a tremendous success. Now it is more than a decade, and there are enormous number of courses, both web-based and video-based. More than 900 plus courses are available by excellent teachers from all over IITs, IISCs, and several others. It was only available, even it was rendered through YouTube. Many of you might hear, my own lectures are there, available on YouTube on basic electronics. Someone interested can go and have a look. And there are almost on every topic, not necessarily engineering topic, even social sciences, economics, etc. Even high school topics, they are all there. JEE, for example, they are there. And the advantage, of course, is the reach, the access. Everybody, you don't have to have an internet even. You can download from any internet browser center and you can watch it later at your own leisure. Okay? This became a very important and excellent development, and to some extent, the idea came from MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology in the US, which many of you might know, one of the leading top universities in the US, and they started what is known as OCW, Open Courseware, where again, the same idea they implemented. The professors in MIT, be it a physics professor Walter Levin or whatever, and those will be captured and then put in a video, and then that will be shared with everybody in the world. And so what has happened now is there are hundreds of such things have come. Many consortium of universities in the US, for example, edX, Coursera, etc., they are all coming together to develop such course material so that people in any part, not necessarily people from US, it can be people from any part of the world, will be able to access them and learn from those professors. And of course, that one disadvantage is that there is no examination compound, both in the NPTEL and the OCW. But those things are now changed. There is a new development which is called Massive Online Courses, MOOC, MOOCs they are called. Massive online course materials, which are again available from several universities, including in Indian NPTEL also now is going in the MOOCs mode. And there you can also register for a course and you can write an exam. They conduct an exam, and if you do well, they will give you a certificate also. Previously, the courses were available, it is more for knowledge sake. But you know, if it is only for knowledge sake, many people may not be willing to take it up. They would like to make sure that they are able to learn from it and then get some degree or diploma or certificate out of it. Especially these kind of courses are very useful to not only fresh students in colleges and schools, etc., but also people who are already employed in different areas. For example, IT sector. There are so many new developments happening. Suddenly there is what is known as artificial intelligence, which is becoming very popular. Machine learning, they call it. That is becoming very popular. So there are a lot of new subjects which are coming up, and those things also have to be learned. So you have to upgrade as you go along. Therefore, you must have some access to some newer topics which have happened after you left the colleges. New things have happened. Many new courses have been developed, and they will enhance your employability or your promotional prospects and things like that. Therefore, you can start registering for those courses and get certificates. So, I have come across a few cases where some of my own colleagues in IIT Tirupati and other IITs they started taking classes online during this lockdown period by using some simple innovative ideas. So they just made PowerPoint slides. Many teachers make PowerPoint slides so that when they teach in a classroom, even a normal classroom, it is very convenient, because you know, PowerPoint slides prompts the teacher what is to be told next. So he doesn't have to mug up, or if there is a very complicated picture which he cannot draw easily, he can already copy the picture onto his slide and he can project the slide and explain. Thereby he can save a lot of time, both for the students as well as for the class. And therefore PowerPoint slides are very, very useful. And when you make a PowerPoint slide, or some of the teachers may have ready-made PowerPoint slides which they have been teaching this course for many number of years, and therefore in the lockdown condition they put the PowerPoint slide, switch on the microphone and switch on a app or a small software tool which will capture whatever is on the screen along with the microphone. So the teacher keeps on showing the slide one after another, keep explaining the ideas to the classroom as if he's teaching to a classroom, and the voice also is recorded, the video also is recorded, the slides are there, he can explain the slide, whatever that is contained in that, and then he is now putting it in some YouTube or any other thing, and he will share through email or through other modes, Google Drive or whatever, to all his students so that they can view it whenever they are free, whenever they feel like watching. So there is no compulsion that they all should log in at the same time and watch. Most of the time, you know what happens, even in our own classes, they just log in, and the moment they log in, you think they are attending your course. It may not happen, you know, they will be just going away and doing some other work somewhere. We have no way of knowing whether sitting in front of the monitor and watching what all I am saying. You understand what I am saying? So that such things happen even in a normal classroom, you know. People will be physically present but mentally absent, or they will be looking at the window or looking at thinking about something else, or they may be using their WhatsApp, all kinds of things, you know. I don't have to tell you what are all the innovative ways that whereby students cheat the teachers when they are in classroom, in a physical classroom, or at home, not in a physical classroom, you know, that such things do happen all the time. So the one of the innovations, not only by using the slide and the voice over, you can record as a video and share with your students. In addition, you can do also one more thing. You can focus the camera towards your whiteboard if you have one at home, and you can write anything, mathematical equations and etc., and you can project it so that the students can also see as if they are sitting in a classroom and watching a blackboard teaching. In case you don't have such a whiteboard, you still can be innovative. You can actually use your mobile phone camera, put a pile of books and put the camera of the mobile phone at the top. At the bottom you can have a clip pad which we normally use for a written examination, pen and paper examination, and you start writing on the paper and the camera of the mobile phone will capture it, and you can connect it to the USB of your laptop, and you can even share with, instead of a blackboard, a notepad. Of course, you also know the technology has come to a stage where if you have an iPad and a stylus or a pen, you may be able to teach by writing on the iPad whatever you want, all equations and figures, etc., and share with your students. So you find there are enormous number of innovations which are lying around. Some are being focused now because of this lockdown, and these things will become a part of our teaching methodology, and so education is going to go through a major change in future for good. And so you may be able to go through that, and we may be making use of such tools in our classrooms in the future. But with all these
distance education more, there is one other very important thing that we have to worry about, which I already mentioned to you. That is, it is not just attending classes, but ultimately gaining some credit for it in the form of a credit, marks, or some grades, or some certificate, or diploma, or something like that. So, therefore, if we have such lockdown conditions, for example, many of the examinations are postponed because we do not know when we can conduct our exams. But if there is a way to conduct examinations also online, okay, so there are many online exams which you already know, like JEE, NEET exam, etc. Some of them have been partially converted into online exam. If we could have such exam, there are some exams which are proctored, as they are called. Proctored means it will be under the watchful eyes of somebody. Somebody may be watching you even though you are at home taking up the examination. In a normal examination hall in a university or a classroom, there will be always invigilators. We will be going around to see whether anybody is copying or anybody is using any malpractices during the examination. But when you are writing in the comfort of your home, you may be a wonderful guy, a very sincere guy, but we can't be assured that everybody is as sincere as you are. So the teachers or the administrators must be aware that nobody is trying to cheat by referring to some notes or books or something like that, because nobody is watching them. So there are, you know, a lot of innovations coming in this line where you can use your camera to see what the student is doing. That camera will be motion sensitive. So if the student starts moving from his chair, it will start recording. And also the using the networking facilities, you can also monitor when a particular student is logging in and when he is logging out. You can make sure he is not able to visit or browse any other sites except the site where the examination is being administered. Like that, there are enormous number of innovations that are coming out in administering distance education examinations, even in the comfort of your home. Still, we are a long way to go. There are several things that we have to make sure we ensure before we make it a foolproof, protected, proctored examination. For example, whenever you talk about online exam, it will mostly refer to a multiple choice examination. In a multiple choice examination, you have only some A, B, C, D choice. Every question throws you with four or five options, and you have to select the option, and if the selection is correct, you will get a mark, and if it is wrong, you will be given zero or something, and you have to go through that. So it becomes a challenge to the paper setter that they have to make the examiner all kinds of problems. They have to make it ultimately into multiple choice or something like an objective type kind of an examination. Therefore, it is highly restrictive. When a student takes an objective or multiple choice type of an examination, when he presses A or B or C as the answer, we as examiners, we have no clue whether the student picked the correct choice by an analytical reasoning or by fluke, just like that guesswork. So in order to avoid that guesswork, these online exams normally introduce what is known as negative marking. So if A is the answer for a multiple choice question, if he presses A, then he will get 3 marks. If he presses any other wrong answer, for example B, he will get -1 mark. So the negative weightage is less, 1/3 only, but still there is there. This is to dissuade the student from simply guessing and putting. For example, there are a few people who will keep on putting yeah for all the questions. He may still get maybe out of 100, 25 marks or 10 marks, 15 marks, which he doesn't deserve, you know. And therefore, you have to have a lot of checks and balances in this kind of examination. However, it would be nice if we could develop an examination
where the student will be able to write either on a notepad with a stylus pen or on a paper, and he may be able to share it on to the examiner, so that the examiner can see how he has worked out the problem, whether he has followed the sequence of things properly and is aware of the principles involved and the formula involved, whether he has correctly invoked the right kind of equations and solved the equations correctly, and those things can be verified. Then we really know that if it is a tough question, if the fellow is doing very well, then we can be very happy to award him the full mark, and there is no guesswork here. So that personally, I don't like the negative grading in examinations, because we should not punish a young student for guessing. As elders, we are all doing guessing in the office, at home, and several other places all the time without getting punished. But at a critical stage, a school guy, school student, for example, when he makes a guess, we punish him by giving a minus one mark, which is, to my mind, is not acceptable. So we must be able to, we must try to be innovative enough to avoid any negative marking and still make a very good assessment of the skill level of the students, so that we may be able to grade them properly at the end of the examination. So there are enormous kind of issues related to education. I have discussed several aspects of this kind of variations that perhaps one can look for in the future. There are a lot of companies, industries, even educationists who are all working, researching in developing such newer tools, so that one can need not come to on campus to study a course on them. There are a lot of predictions made several years ago that maybe in a decade or two, most of our universities, including leading universities like the IITs, MITs and all that, they may have more number of students off campus than on campus. What do you mean by off campus? They'll be in any part of the world. They are not there in the place where the college is located, and still you can get a degree from that university or institution. How is it possible? By distance education. And this has got enormous advantage, because you can quickly take up a job, earn your money, and simultaneously work during your leisure time on any good course from good university. The universities will say, for example, it is BSc Physics or MSc Physics, they will publish the syllabus. These are the topics that you should be familiar with. You can get familiarized with the topic, not necessarily by coming to the campus, staying in the hostel, attending the classes, but you can stay at home and refer through the internet some of the best lectures given by best teachers in any university all over the world, and learn from them, take notes, and then understand the subject, and then say, I'm ready for the exam. The leading universities will conduct only exam at different centers if necessary, and there you go and write, because we still don't have a robust online subjective type of examination scheme. So you can go there to different centers, like you write JEE or NPTEL courses and things like that. You can go to different important nearby towns and write your exams, and if it will be valued by the professors in that university, say MIT, for example. And if he finds your answers are good enough, then you must be getting a degree from the university. You don't have to go there to US and register in the university to get a world-class degree, as long as you are able to get self-motivated and study on your own with the resources already available in the public domain in many of the university sites. And Coursera, edX that I already mentioned to you, NPTEL, etc. And thereby you can equip yourself to take up more challenging jobs and go up higher in the ladder, and there is no limit. Because every institution are looking for somebody who is able to adapt himself in learning new methodologies. So that, see, every technology is only there only for 5 years, 10 years. So where is the VCRs, video cassette players, or where is the camera now? Everything is now gobbled up by somebody called a mobile phone. Smartphone, they call it. It is so smart, it has swallowed many things, you know. It's a recorder, it's a camera, it's a video recording device, okay. You can even use it as a phone sometimes, okay, occasionally. And it has got enormous number of facilities provided in that. And therefore, technology is changing so rapidly. When you pass out of the portals of a university, even if it is a wonderful university, you find you have to constantly upgrade your knowledge as long as you want to be in the line and then be in the forefront of the company. And therefore, these tools that I already mentioned to you, okay, so over the course of this nearly an hour now, are all meant to give you an overview of the various things that one can perhaps take recourse to and learn from them. So I think I have given you an overview of what all the options that can perhaps become a reality shortly after the lockdown is lifted. So you would find you no more, your college also may not be only looking for regular classroom kind of teaching, some amount of this distance mode of education, learning from home, etc., might also become the part of the new normal, as they are calling. So education is looking for a major revision, okay, in terms of online teaching, online learning, online examination, and we must be prepared for these kind of eventualities. Thank you for your attention. Thank you very much.